Hi there. It looks like we have some folks joining now. We're going to wait another moment or two before we get started. So hang tight. Okay, well, hello everyone. Welcome to our Conversations in Genetics webinar. We're gonna go ahead and get started. I think we will have quite a few more people joining in the next few minutes, but we do have a few introductions, so we'll go ahead and get started. So again, welcome. This is our seventh webinar in the series. And this series received funding support from the Nurse Support Program 2, administered by the Maryland Health Education Commission, which is funded under the auspices of the Health Services Cost Review Commission. Today we have an interprofessional panel that includes a nurse, physician, who is an oncologist, and a genetics counselor to discuss how they use genetics and genomics knowledge to provide cancer care for patients. We welcome you to submit your questions in the chat box throughout the webinar. You're also able to unmute and ask questions. And I think we will have a couple spots where we'll welcome you to do just that. So I'm thrilled to introduce our moderator today, Dr. Jennifer Wilder. I have had the great pleasure of working with her over the last year on our Genetics in Nursing grant. Dr. Wilder completed her Doctor of Nursing Practice this year at Johns Hopkins in the clinical nurse specialist track. She plans to use this degree to build on her current role at the National Institutes of Health as the clinical nurse administrator of the Unrelated Donor Stem Cell Transplant Program, where she is an associate investigator on 18 clinical trials. Her 20 years of experience with transplant donor selection, oncology, and immune deficiency patients sparked an interest in genetics and genomics. This led her to complete the City of Hope intensive course in genomic cancer risk assessment. And as a Cohen scholar with the Nurse Support 2 program through the state of Maryland, Jennifer is dedicated to teaching and mentoring other nurses who are interested in oncology, transplant, and genetics. So without further ado, I will turn things over to Dr. Wilder.
Thank you. That's the first time anybody's used my title. So thank you so much for that kind introduction, Dr. Mollenkopf, and thank you all for being here. Today, we're going to focus on the role of genetics in oncology, and our speakers really represent part of the multidisciplinary circle of care that is part of oncology genetics practice. So our first speaker is Grace Ann Passe, and she's a senior genetic counselor at the National Cancer Institute, who serves as an associate investigator on numerous studies within the genetics branch of the Center for Cancer Research. She provides genetic counseling to patients enrolled on surveillance and therapeutic protocols for cancers of the breast, ovaries, stomach, prostate, and lung. She's the lead genetic counselor on NCI's Hereditary Gastric Cancer Syndrome Study, and she's a member of the Hereditary Gastric Cancer Working Group of the NCI Physicians Data Query Cancer Genetics Editorial Board. Throughout her 20-year career, Grace Ann has been committed to training the next generation of clinical genetics providers, mentoring aspiring genetic counselors from underrepresented backgrounds, informing the community about genomics at health events, and educating healthcare providers about genomics. And I'm really privileged to work with Grace Ann at NCI, and thank you, Grace, for being here. Our second speaker, Dr. David Oyhus, received his MD from St. Louis University School of Medicine in 1980. He completed his general and oncologic surgery training at UCLA in 1991, after which he served as a surgical oncologist in the US Army for 5 years. His last duty station was Tripler Army Medical Center in Honolulu, Hawaii. He spent 17 years at UT Southwestern Medical Center in Dallas, where he was the director of clinical cancer genetics and the associate director for clinical research in the Simmons Comprehensive Cancer Center. His primary research interests are mathematical and molecular breast cancer risk stratification. He's the author of Cancer Genes, a popular cancer genetics risk assessment program, and the originator of the web-based platform Cancer Gene Connect. He's been professor of surgery at the Johns Hopkins Hospital since 2013. So as you can see, as a nurse, a genetic counselor, and a oncologist, our speakers sort of cover the some of the disciplines that are involved in oncology genetics. Each will give brief presentations and we'll have some time for questions. Please feel free to post questions in the chat box during the presentations, and we will take those questions in at a couple of different time points. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Grace Ann to get us started.
Thank you, Jen, for that introduction. I'm very pleased to be here today, and I also thank you for the invitation and all the other webinar organizers for having me here to give this talk. I'm going to jump right into it. We're going to discuss germline and somatic testing, specifically results interpretation and implications for oncology patients. Next slide, please. So the objectives of the talk will be to give us some foundation by reviewing some basic concepts, especially how I explain these concepts to patients, to really help to distinguish between somatic versus germline testing. We'll examine an unfolding clinical case scenario to help with our learning process involving a patient who underwent both germline and somatic testing. We'll discuss genetic counseling and testing referral indications based on somatic finding, but also based on the patient's clinical profile, their cancer history, and also the family history of cancer. And we'll identify available resources for results interpretation and support. And I'll be bringing Dr. Oyhus into the conversation for that multidisciplinary aspect. Next slide, please. So our case study is John. John is a 52-year-old man with a brain tumor. He has an astrocytoma. It was treated with surgery and he underwent a round of chemotherapy, Temodar, which he took for 2 years. He had a positive response, but unfortunately after a 3-year remission, he did have a recurrence. He was put on Temodar again, but became resistant to it. And so he was switched to another chemotherapy regimen. He was also given tumor testing. It was ordered specifically to do sequencing of the genetic variants within his tumor to determine possible targets for therapeutics. Next slide, please. So for patients like John, often one of the questions that they may have if they're undergoing any type of gene test, even if it's a somatic test looking for genetic variants in the tumor, they may be wondering, are brain cancers genetic? Or is my cancer genetic in general? And the answer to that question is the foundation of helping us to understand the difference between somatic testing and germline testing. And that's because all cancers are genetic due to somatic mutations that accumulate over time and lead to cells to grow out of control and form tumors. However, not all cancers are hereditary, meaning someone was born with a genetic variant. A pathogenic variant is another way that we say mutation now. Not everyone is born with a mutation that makes them susceptible to cancer, but all cancers are something that arises from genetic mutations that take place in a cell. Next slide, please. So this is a slide that I sometimes share with patients. It's a visual aid for patients. It was created by the National Society of Genetic Counselors. And it just goes through the foundations of our cells, and inside of our cells, that's where our chromosomes are. And our chromosomes are tightly coiled DNA that can be separated out into genes. And we have over 20,000 genes. We know hundreds of them are related to controlling our cells. It's normal for our cells to grow, but we don't want them to grow out of control. So there's genes that really regulate and help to repair damage to our cells to prevent cancer. So we want those genes to be working correctly. We want the DNA base pairs to be spelled out correctly, because if there is a mutation, a variant, a pathogenic variant within the DNA, that could start the process of the accumulation of mutations within the cell that could lead to cancer. Next slide, please. And so this is, again, showing the DNA strand. And oftentimes when we think about DNA analysis, we talk a lot about sequencing, DNA sequencing, which is really looking at the order of the chemical base pairs of a gene. And so I give the example of a sentence for patients, because sequencing is like a spell check, making sure that the DNA is spelled out correctly, just like a spell check, make sure that, you know, words in a document are spelled out correctly. So just one single change, one base pair change, is similar to one change in the letter of a sentence, and it can change the meaning of a gene. Just like with this sentence, the meaning is changed. So for instance, the gray cat ran down the hall. One letter change, the gray cat ran down the ball, and the sentence no longer makes any sense. So changes in the DNA might change the way a gene works. And we can analyze genes that we are born with. That's called germline testing. And when someone is diagnosed with a cancer, they possibly could have a somatic test looking for DNA mutations that they've acquired over their lifetime. And somatic DNA changes oftentimes, most of the time, are very different from the germline DNA that you're born with. Next slide. So this is just showing the various types of genetic variants. We don't have to go through all of this, but again, it's using that sentence example, which I sometimes find helpful with a patient, you know, just showing the different ways, just these subtle changes, you know, inserted DNA or missing or duplicated DNA base pairs can lead to genetic variants that can be pathogenic. Next slide. So cancer development, again, is an accumulation of mutations. Acquiring mutations over someone's lifetime is something that can happen. And again, there's certain cancer genes that can correct these types of mutations and fix them. But there's some people who are born with a germline mutation in one of these cancer cells, one of these tumor suppressor genes, or these DNA repair genes. They may be born with an error. That doesn't mean that they'll definitely develop cancer. It just means they're susceptible to cancer. But then it's not just that one mutation that someone's born with. There's several other mutations that need to happen. Again, it's accumulation of mutations that can lead to tumors to grow. The majority of people who develop cancer are not born with a strong genetic susceptibility to cancer. Most people, their cancers are due just to the accumulation of a DNA damage and mutation. Most of the time, we don't know what causes it. There are some known carcinogens, like cigarette smoking, sun exposure for skin cancers, but most of the time it's not really clear why this DNA damage happens. Next slide. So again, when we think about somatic versus germline variant, sometimes they can get a little muddled. So I just wanted to talk separately about the differences. Somatic mutations, tumor mutations, tumor variants, that's something that's in a specific person. It's usually not something that's passed on to them. And because of that, they cannot pass it on to their children. These mutations are only in the tumor most of the time. And so because of that, we're focused on how understanding that DNA, those genetic changes can impact a patient's treatment. What are some of the targets or therapeutics that we can get, that we can learn about from analyzing someone's tumor DNA that's in them? Whereas with germline testing, germline mutations usually are inherited from parents. Sometimes they can happen at conception, that we call those de novo mutations. But when that happens, we know that it's still in every cell of their body. And when someone has a germline mutation, that can be passed on to their children, to their offspring. And so it has implications not only for the patient, it has implications for the family as well if someone has a germline mutation or pathogenic variant. And germline mutations may increase the risk for cancer. That's important for a cancer patient to know, are they at risk for a second cancer? And it's also important for family members who are at risk to get tested because it could impact their cancer screening as far as starting screening earlier. It can also impact treatments for patients who are diagnosed with cancer in some scenarios. And again, because germline mutations are present in all cells of the body, germline variants can sometimes be found in a tumor. And so tumor testing sometimes can inform whether or not to have a germline test. Next slide. So this just shows how variants are classified and thought about in the germline setting versus somatic setting. Germline variants have 5 different levels of classification, from pathogenic to benign. And then in the middle there, we have variants of uncertain significance. That's when we see these subtle changes within a gene, and there's just not enough evidence to definitively determine whether it's disease-causing or pathogenic, or if it's benign. When we have that type of result, it's considered not clinically actionable. We base our, you know, recommendations for the patient and their family members on the personal and family history of cancer. We wait until the variant is either upgraded to likely pathogenic, which is often treated like a pathogenic finding as far as surveillance and management options for the patient, or downgraded to likely benign. So if your patient gets a result that's a variant of uncertain significance, over time, eventually the variant will be reclassified. The laboratory should be contacting the ordering provider, and then the provider would share those results with the patient. Most of the time, variants are downgraded, about 90% of the time, but there are variants sometimes that are upgraded to likely pathogenic. So it's important to keep a watch out for reclassification of a patient's uncertain variants. On the somatic side, the categories that we think about, somatic variants, so variants within the tumor, can inform diagnostics, prognostics, as far as how aggressive the tumor may be. And what we think about most is therapeutics. What are some of the targets or treatments that the patient will respond to based on their somatic genetic variation? Next slide. So when a patient comes to us with a test report, and you know, even if they're referred to us because of a genetic finding, we always want to see the test report. We want to take a look at it, especially because somatic testing is becoming more common for certain types of patients. So we really want to clarify and understand, is it a somatic genetic finding or is it something in the germline? Some clues that can help us understand that is the name of the lab performing the test, Over time, as you get comfortable looking at these tests, you know, some these test reports, some labs are more in the realm of germline testing, some do more somatic testing. A lot of the labs are getting into both, but it is very helpful to know the name of the lab. If it's a clinical test, clinical grade testing, or was it research testing, especially as it pertains to germline testing, where patients are making decisions, relatives are being offered testing. We want to make sure that research germline findings are retested in a clinical diagnostic lab to confirm the finding. We want to know the name of the test that was performed, the date of sample collection and analysis, because again, oftentimes that can inform whether the patient needs additional testing, depending on how long ago they were tested. And really a key to understanding whether the test is was done on the tumor or the germline is the type of sample. So germline findings are typically something that can be found from a blood test, a blood sample, a saliva sample, or a buccal sample. And buccal is a cheek swab. Whereas somatic findings, the specimen type tend to be something where they're talking about tissue that's analyzed from a slide or from a tissue block. Next slide, please. So if we go back to our case example, so John, this is his test report. So he had the testing to determine therapeutics. You know, if a patient comes to me, if a patient is referred to me because of their somatic test report, I'm looking to see the specimen type, which is on top right over there. It's saying that it's a brain astrocytoma. The specimen type, if you go a little bit down, Jen is showing that it's a slide. So we know it's a tissue sample that's on a slide. I'm really trying to figure out, because, you know, it has listed on the bottom right in that box, all the genomic alterations that were found. As a genetic counselor, I'm typically looking for those genes that I'm familiar with as being associated with inherited cancer susceptibility. And that would be the TP53 gene stands out for me, which is associated with hereditary form syndrome that's associated with breast cancer and sarcomas and brain tumors, and the CDH1 gene, which is a couple more down, might be covered with the captioning. But the CDH1 gene is associated with breast cancer and inherited susceptibility found in the germline to breast cancer and stomach cancer. So as a genetic counselor, that's what I'm looking at. For an oncologist, they may be looking more so what type of therapeutics can I offer the patient? So if you go to the next slide, this shows the FDA approved therapies based on the patient's tumor genetic profile and possible clinical trials. So at this point, I wanted to ask Dr. Oihus a question. Next slide.
Sure.
Okay. So yeah, I just wanted to ask you, if a patient were to come to you with their somatic results, or if you have a patient who had somatic testing after their surgery, how do you use that in the care of your patient? And how do you, what type of support do you have for results interpretation?
So we're fortunate at Hopkins to have a molecular tumor board run by Jesse Tao. So all of the somatic tests are reviewed by a panel of oncologists, and the treatment recommendations are made based on that. So that's a great resource. Mm-hmm. Like you know, we look through those genes and say, you know, do we need to think more about P53? Of course, that's like the most commonly mutated gene in tumors. So we wonder about family history and does that support this possibly being germline? And then I'm sure you're going to talk to us more about moving on to germline testing from the somatic result.
Yep, exactly. That was wonderful setup for what I'll be discussing next. So molecular tumor boards are extremely helpful. That's something that, you know, certain, you know, centers of excellence, NCI comprehensive cancer centers, those are the type of places where you see molecular tumor boards, but more and more health systems are starting to form those multidisciplinary types of resources to help with interpretation of reports. But in some cases, there are providers who don't have access to that. And so I'll just walk through some of the other strategies that can be used to determine whether a somatic mutation is in the germline. Next slide. And so when assessing the likelihood that a variant is in the tumor, is in the germline, one thing that I look for, which I did a little bit with that, looking at that test report, is it in an actionable gene defined by the American College of Medical Genetics and Genomics, or ACMG? I have a link here to the ACMG list, is how we refer to it. So actionable meaning, if a patient has a pathogenic variant in this particular gene, there's something that there's evidence-based that there's something that they can do to reduce their risk of cancer or surveillance that may be available. Another key way to kind of tease apart when we see a pathogenic variant in a tumor and whether it's in the germline is there certain mutations that you don't tend to see very often within a tumor. So for instance, there's up here BRCA2 and SDHB. Whenever you see that in a tumor, that may be a red flag that it could be in the germline, as opposed to, for instance, TP53. TP53 is a commonly mutated gene in cancers. Like close to 50% of cancers, if you were to analyze it on the somatic level, would have a TP53 mutation. But TP53 can be mutated in the germline too. So that's where, like Dr. Oyhuth was saying, you have to analyze what type of cancer does the patient have? What is the family history to determine whether to test in the germline? And then, you know, I already said the last one, the tumor type and family history is important. Next slide, please. So as far as family history, that's a key piece of what I do as a genetic counselor when I see a patient. Just to orient you all to anyone who's not familiar with pedigrees. So the squares are men, the circles are females. The cursor right now is on the patient, John, and there's an arrow pointing to him. There's shading in for cancer diagnosis. He has a brother, he has a sister who unfortunately passed away at 15. So if there's a line going through the symbol, that means they're deceased. He has a son and a daughter. His mom passed away from colon cancer at 68. He reports no history on his father's side. His maternal grandfather passed away from gastric cancer. So as far as looking at his family history, again, those two genes that stood out to me were CDH1. CDH1 is associated with increased risk of gastric cancer, which we see in his grandfather. And we're also thinking about TP53. And TP53 can be associated with brain tumors. So there's definitely indication for test him for both of those genes in the germline. And we would typically, what we would do is order a panel, which means testing for several genes at the same time, which is, you know, cost effective and saves time to do it that way. Next slide. So this is a test report. So for in this particular patient, we see the sample in the middle there was saliva sample. He tested negative for the TP53 variant, no surprise because they're so common somatically, but in this germline, so this is his germline report. He didn't have the TP53 pathogenic variant, but he does have the CDH1 variant. Next slide. And so this lab, which is Invitae, they provide details. And most of the germline labs who are doing germline testing will provide their justification for why they have classified the variant as pathogenic, or, you know, if it was uncertain significance, they also would provide that information. What's key to keep in mind is if you ever have questions about a test report or you don't understand it, most labs that do germline testing have a team of genetic counselors who are skilled at education and working with providers to help with the results interpretation. Most don't interact with patients, but they do interact with providers to help them tease apart when to test patients, what types of tests to order, and then also to walk them through the results interpretation. Next slide, please. And so for this particular patient, his somatic results informed his germline. And so it not only impacts him, because most people may think if I'm having a tumor test, it's just going to tell information about my tumor and its aggressiveness and treatment. But it's important for them to know that genomic testing can also inform whether there's something going on in the germline. And so the ACMG recommends this particular language during the consent process for tumor testing. Patients should be told that tumor testing may uncover DNA changes or variants that increase the risk for cancer. Such findings may be inherited and could have health implications for you and your family. If found, your doctor may refer you for additional testing and genetic counseling. Next slide, please. So going back to CDH1, so for this patient and for his family, any family members that test positive, CDH1 is associated with a significantly increased risk for diffuse gastric cancer, lobular breast cancer in women, and also a non-cancerous finding of cleft lip and palate. There are some rare variants of CDH1 that increase the risk for another syndrome, BCD syndrome. Next slide. So going back to the patient's family history, you know, unfortunately this patient did pass away from his astrocytoma, but the CDH1 mutation was confirmed in him in his germline before he passed away, which allowed for his daughter to undergo genetic testing as well as his son. His son tested negative for CDH1, but his daughter did tested positive. So she has the pathogenic variant. And the recommendation would be for her to begin surveillance to look for gastric cancer, to catch it early, which is what she adhered to. She was actually diagnosed with a stage 1, very early stage gastric cancer. And this mutation, as I've been mentioning, also increases the risk for breast cancer. So I'm gonna ask Dr. Oihus another question. As far as this young woman, she has a high risk, we know now, for breast cancer, but she doesn't have a family history of breast cancer. You know, what would you tell this patient if she were to come to you?
She has a kind of a small family there with a lot of boys. So not that surprised that they're not seeing any family history of breast cancer. So we would start screening her with MRI, probably to age 30.
Okay.
And even more difficult is when you get the CDH1 with a bunch of breast cancers in the family, and then there's no gastric cancer in the family. It's like, well, I'll ask you back, what do you do with people's stomachs in those families?
Right. So that's a good question, because we know that initially when CDH1 was characterized, it was characterized as highly penetrant for gastric cancer, up to 83%. But that had to do with ascertainment bias, because we were just looking at gastric cancer families and studying them, so we're going to see a high risk. Now that we're doing panel testing and patients are getting tested because they have breast cancer or family history, like you're saying, Dr. Oihus, we're finding families that just have breast cancer and not gastric cancer. So what we're telling those patients is that our understanding of CDH1, it's evolving. The recommendations are based on not having effective surveillance strategies for CDH1, and often gastric cancer can be diagnosed late stage. And so because of that, gastrectomy is still what is recommended, so removing the stomach, but it's a personal choice, and it's something that they can think about over time. And in the meantime, surveillance with the upper endoscopies with random biopsies would be recommended. And then it's a personal decision what they decide to do. Some people can live with the risk and sleep at night, and some people just feel too nervous and they do go through with the gastrectomy. Next slide, please. So this is why multidisciplinary care is so important for patients with inherited factors. We all come at it from different angles. So when it comes to CDH1, it's important to make sure to refer your patient to providers who have an understanding of CDH1, referring them to a clinical research study. So I'm a genetic counselor on a hereditary gastric protocol. I'm the lead genetic counselor on that particular study. It's a natural history study, but we are also offering clinical care to patients. And this is the team of providers that we work with. And it's so broad because of the implications, the morbidity associated with gastrectomy, important to have dietitians involved, and then also breast specialists for the breast cancer risk, and then to deal with some of the emotional aspects of care, psychologists and nurses play a key role in helping us coordinate care of patients and education of patients as well. Next slide. Thank you. And also research can be helpful because we're still trying to understand the spectrum of cancers that are associated with these variants in CDH1 and in other genes too that have been studied longer, like BRCA1 and 2. We're still learning of other possible associations. So just out of Germany, so just a few months ago, a study out of Germany showed that a higher rate of pathogenic variants in CDH1 in brain tumors. So brain tumors aren't in the spectrum of CDH1 right now. These types of studies need to be replicated to really figure out if there's a strong association or increased risk, or whether this is just a finding that may not be associated with increased risk. But there's still a lot to learn. So I think to take a take-home message, our patient John had a brain tumor, but it informed for his family history, there's his family members, their risk for breast cancer and gastric cancer. A study out of Washington University found that out of 12 cancer types, inherited mutations were identified. So if someone has a stomach cancer, even a lung cancer, we shouldn't be ruling out that there could possibly be a genetic factor. It's not just breast and ovarian and colon that could have genetic factors involved. Whether or not, again, these are associations that really increase risk, or someone just got a sporadic cancer in a hereditary family, is something that still needs to be teased apart. Next slide. Thank you. So as far as germline testing for a patient with any type of cancer, it's so important to look at their tumor type. Is it a rare type? Is it a type that's associated with a hereditary syndrome? What was their age of onset? Do they have a history of previous cancers, someone with multiple cancers? That's an indication for germline testing. So these are some of the more traditional indications for referral. We talked about one of the newer referral indications as far as somatic finding. So this slide just goes through some of the more traditional indications. You know, family history, early age of onset is typically considered less than 50, multiple primary cancers, multiple affected generations. And rare cancers. And there's certain cancers such as male breast cancer, ovarian, pancreatic, where we don't really even need to know the family history. Just based on the NCCN guidelines, they're eligible for germline testing just based on that diagnosis of that rare cancer alone. Next slide, please. Thank you. And so cascade testing in John's family, his daughter, his son got tested, but other family members did not. And when you hear this phrase cascade testing, it basically means knowing who else is at risk in the family and offering them testing. The goal of germline testing is to help to reduce the burden of cancer by being able to detect it early or reduce people's risk, reduce that burden one family at a time. Next slide. But cascade testing can have barriers. Studies have shown that 10 to 50% of at-risk relatives undergo genetic testing. So that number is much lower than I would like it to be. I think most genetics providers would like that number to be higher in the 90s, but it's complicated. You know, some probands may not want to share their information or may not feel comfortable with it. There's studies showing that the proband, which is the first person who tested positive in the family, that's typically how we use proband. In some cases, they may want their provider to be the one to tell their relatives, but there's ethical and legal reasons why that there's a challenge for providers to reach out to family members directly. The families are complicated. There's lots of dynamics. Some family members have open versus closed communication when it comes to topics in general, but especially with health information. And then the healthcare system. So the proband may have access to genetic, to healthcare. They have access to, they're insured, but their relatives may have barriers as far as their insurability and access to a genetics provider. Next slide. Next slide, please. Is it not forwarding? Okay, thanks, Jen. So the CDC has template letters to help families, to help facilitate that process of families sharing their information. So the last few slides are really just resources, and there are links at the bottom. Next slide, please. So this just shows, this is from CDC's website. It's for BRCA 1 and 2. It's a template for BRCA 1 and 2, showing the importance of genetic testing. It's something that a proband could mail to their, print out and mail after they amend it, or it can be copy and paste into an email. Next slide. There's a website called kintalk.org. It's out of UCSF, and again, it helps with family communication by creating these templates, email templates, to share results with family members and to share information about the indications. Next slide. Invitae Labs and some other labs also have testing programs. They're helping to facilitate the testing process. So if the initial testing was done at Invitae within 150 days, relatives can have no-cost testing. So again, it's important to contact the laboratory if you have questions about cascade testing, because many laboratories are offering these types of low-cost or no-cost testing options. Next slide. There's a lab called Color. They don't accept health insurance, but they've really reduced the cost to $50. If there's a mutation in the family, you can be tested at any lab to be eligible for Color's program. And again, there's websites here, but if you Google these sites, you'll find their websites and then also customer service phone numbers to ask questions. Next slide, please. And then as far as helping to tease this apart, genetic counselors, we're here for you to do that. Many genetic counselors are providing telehealth services. We were even before COVID, but even more so now because of COVID. Again, another plug for laboratory genetic counselors. They're there for a resource, most as a resource for providers. Their phone number, the customer service phone number, is typically on lab reports, but also you can Google them or you can try to find them through this Find a Genetic Counselor feature. You can enter in the name of the lab and the names of genetic counselors at certain labs will pop up. Next slide. And again, this is just additional resources, patient-friendly resources, but also resources for healthcare providers, because our knowledge base of different genes that are related to hereditary factors is growing, it's changing constantly. And so these are different resources that are out of NIH, also out of NCCN, that are constantly being updated. Thank you. I'll turn it over to Dr. Boyhus now.
Thanks. Wow, Grace, that was the clearest presentation of the complex issues associated with genetic testing I've ever heard. So
well, thank you.
It's really, really good. So I remember the mid-90s when BRCA1 sequence got reported and genetic testing became a commercial enterprise. And there was a lot of uncertainty about it. We didn't know what's going to happen in terms of insurance discrimination. We didn't know if there was going to be a huge psychological impact from finding out that you have a change in your DNA that makes you high risk for breast cancer. So that is when genetic counseling really expanded as the first with BRCA1 and then with more of the syndromes. And it was it was a complicated process to have a patient screen for willingness and appropriateness of testing, and then doing the testing, which took like 6 weeks to get a result back, and then doing something about the results. And I, you know, things have changed a lot. It's become a lot more commonplace to do the testing. And one of my main crusades is having genetic testing available for every newly diagnosed breast cancer patient. And in 15 years ago, we were still being pretty selective about who we tested. And I sent all my patients to the genetic counselor. I was the boss of the genetic counselors back then. So I could get same day, counseling, and we could get the tests sent out. But with just as the indications for testing kind of expanded and the number of people that needed to be tested expanded, it really became too much for genetic counselors to be screening patients for mutations, and testing moved into the individual clinics. So now we had to train nurses and PAs and nurse practitioners to do a lot of this screening. So it's become demystified, and I'll just have a very brief presentation here about some of the nuts and bolts on testing. So if you can hit the forward arrow. So there's enormous value to genetic testing. Here's a pedigree showing a few scattered people with breast cancer in red, and they're a gastric cancer in green up there, and then forward arrow, there you go. So I need, as I just one arrow at a time, as I'm seeing this new breast cancer patient, you know, at 64, I need the genetic test results so I can make a decision or help the patient make a decision about, do we do a lumpectomy or do we really need to do a mastectomy? Oh, do we need to do a double mastectomy? What's the contralateral breast cancer risk? One of the important questions when you're thinking about lumpectomy is the radiation. Do they have a TP53 mutation? Because I don't want to radiate them if they do. So I need to know that before we're committed to lumpectomy and radiation. If we're going to do radiation, can it be partial breast radiation? Or should we do whole breast radiation? I need the genetic test result to make that decision. And then when we get on to systemic therapy, this is more for advanced metastatic breast cancer, but is this somebody that should be getting platinum chemotherapy instead of Taxol-based? Can we use PARP inhibitors? Now FDA approved for BRCA1 and 2 breast cancer patients. Next arrow. And as Grace was talking with the cascade testing, we can, if we find a mutation in our patient, we can impact a whole generation by finding out who's high risk and who's not high risk. So we can get the high risk people into enhanced surveillance. We can talk about chemo prevention with tamoxifen. If it's BRCA1, 2, PALB2, one of the high risk genes, we could talk about prophylactic mastectomy. If it's an ovarian cancer gene, we can save their lives by doing a prophylactic salpingo-oophorectomy. So I hope that convinces you that pretty much we've got to think about genetic testing, and it should be part of the workup of every new breast cancer patient within reason. Next, forward arrow. So the genetic testing process, like I said, in the mid-90s, it was really complex. 15 years ago, it was less complex, but still pretty complex. It's really become streamlined in my practice. Everybody should have pre-test counseling. You do the testing, and then you do the post-test counseling. Next arrow. Pre-test counseling does not need to be an hour or two sitting with the genetic counselor. I spend 5 or 10 minutes doing it, and these are the main points. And I've got a nice smart phrase in Epic that documents that this is what we talked about, but I want to let the patient know if we do the genetic testing, we may discover you're high risk for other cancers like gastric cancer. And do you want to know that? Do you want to be subjected to the endoscopies or perhaps even the prophylactic surgery that goes with that? I tell them that a negative test won't necessarily mean that you're not at high risk for cancer. The testing may provide no useful information at all. That'd be like a VUS variant of uncertain significance. It just, it's as though we didn't do the test. I tell them that the out-of-pocket cost generally ranges from $0 to $250, and that if they're positive, each of the close family members has a 50-50 chance of being positive too. So you're going to want to communicate with your family and do the cascade testing that Grace was talking about. And a positive, it's true, a positive test could affect your ability to get some types of insurance, but we certainly have not seen significant insurance discrimination as a result of genetic testing. And there's laws like the GINA law that prevents most types of discrimination. So that's it, pretest counseling, 5 or 10 minutes. Next slide. And then the testing, not that complicated. You pick your test provider, and I'll tell you that they all use the same next generation sequencing technology, and they're all pretty much, you give them 1,000 samples, they're all pretty much going to find the same variants. What might be a little different is how they classify the variants. So some of the genetic testing companies have a lot of experience and some really good algorithms for classifying these variants, and some are a little newer at it. So I'd put that in parentheses because it's really getting into the weeds. But you have lots of options now for your genetic test provider, and it really gets down to convenience and customer service. How quickly can I get an order in? Will they do the insurance pre-screen for me? Will they do all the legwork for me? And how fast can they get a result back? Those are kind of the practical considerations. You order the test online, and I very supportive of doing multi-gene panel tests. I remember even 6-7 years ago, people were having meetings to decide which genes to combine in panels. And I think we're all realizing that if you don't test as much as you can, then 5-10 years from now, you're going to go back and be retesting people who have strong family histories and then non-informative negative gene tests. So I use a 47 gene panel whenever I test. And then you help the patient with their blood or their saliva kit. You just mail it in, and there it is. You've done the genetic testing. No muss, no fuss. Next step, post-test counseling. Now, when you get the result back, the very first thing you have to do is refine your estimates of the patient's cancer risks and make a plan. And, with all the new genes, PALB2, ATM, CHEK2, NBN, all the whole list, it gets difficult to kind of maintain risk estimates and how you calculate that just at the top of your head. So you can use a program like Ask2Me, which I'll show you on the next slide, if it's pathogenic or likely pathogenic, to come up with a estimate of their cancer risk. If it comes back negative, then first thing you want to know, was there a pathogenic variant in the family and this person just happens to be negative? Because that's a good thing. They're probably not at high risk if that's the case. That's where I turn to the risk models like BRCA Pro, Klaus model, Tyrer-Cuzick, all those different things to give them an estimate of risk. And then the variants of uncertain significant. Again, you turn to the risk models, and you should have a system for keeping track of your VUS patients, but nobody has a good system. And they return the updated classification to the providers, but providers change and patients move. And this is something we really need to work on from a centralized informatics perspective, a way of getting back to our patients once they get reclassified. Next slide. So here's the Ask2Me calculator, all syndromes known to man. There's the web address up there. I use it all the time. And like, for instance, you go in, you put in, my patient had a CHEK2 1100 Del-C mutation. It's a woman, she's 42 years old. And it'll print out your breast cancer risk up there saying, 22%? And the green bar is the non-carrier colorectal cancer risk around 5%. and kidney cancer risk around 5%. And it'll do that for a whole range of these genes that are on the panel. So invaluable resource. Next slide. When I first started moving testing out of the genetic counselor office into the clinic, I was anxious about it, and I wanted to make sure the nurse practitioner doing the testing was as trained up as possible. And this course, the City of Hope course run by Jeff Weitzel, is still is a Cadillac course for nurses and nurse practitioners who are going to have a lot of independence in their testing. So you can kind of look that up and do that course if that's the level you want. Next slide. But for me and for working with a nurse, I would just look at the ASCO education websites. There's a whole menu of different topics related to genetic testing. And if you run through that and you're working with someone that's knowledgeable and experienced with the genetic testing, you'll have a very good fund of knowledge for getting through this. And then next slide. Okay, that's it. So if we have time for a clinical scenario or not.
I think if it's okay, we can keep going with the clinical scenario. For those of you who need to drop off, please feel free. This is being recorded, so you can come back and watch this. Dr. Oyhus and Grace, are you guys okay to stay on for a few more minutes and walk through this case?
Yes, yeah. I can.
Okay, great. So this case was provided by Dr. Oyhus, and it's a 48-year-old woman with a 1.2 centimeter left breast density seen on a screening mammogram. A sonocore returned a grade 2 invasive ductal carcinoma that was triple negative, and she has no family history of breast cancer. And her father is an only child. So Dr. Oyhus, would you offer genetic testing?
Yeah, I hope I made my point clear that I consider genetic testing for every single new breast cancer patient. How about you, Grace? Do you still
right.
have criteria? So, or?
Yeah, I know that there was a surgical expert group that recommends genetic testing for all breast cancer patients. I guess, and I've heard that some people have been able to figure out a way to get insurance to cover that. I think it's still not part of the NCCN guidelines to test all patients.
Right.
However, you know, there have been ways that providers and genetic counselors have figured out to get coverage for every patient with breast cancer. So it really just depends. But definitely if a patient has triple negative breast cancer, like your patient, and they're young, she's definitely a candidate for testing.
And then what tests would you send?
I would do a large panel just like you, just because breast cancer overlaps with so many different genes, right?
Yeah. And I think there was so much debate about this 5 years ago, but I think it's settling down and most people mm-hmm. are the large panels now.
I agree.
So her multi-gene panel test that you guys sent returns BRCA1, IVS20, and 1GA pathogenic mutation. And she's trying to decide whether to go for a lumpectomy and radiation, left mastectomy, or bilateral mastectomy. Is it safe to have radiation with BRCA1?
Well, I will, absolutely, yes, it is. BRCA1 carriers don't have any increased toxicity with radiation. It doesn't increase their risk of contralateral breast cancer from side scatter, and it's just as effective as it is in other women. The one gene where it kind of, you know, where it kind of is it comes up in discussions is ATM, because everybody knows that kids with ataxia telangiectasia who have inherited two abnormal ATM genes, they can have horrible toxicity from radiation. But our breast cancer patients with one variant allele, they do not have terrible complications with the radiation, and it's fine to offer them breast conservation. Interestingly, the most recent studies, the largest best done studies, show that the local recurrence risk in the breast is not much more than it is for a sporadic patient. The radiation really shuts down that that breast, and maybe it's a 0.7 or maybe one, actually, I'm sorry, it'd be a little more than that, maybe 1% per year risk of a local recurrence. And these are young women, usually with higher risk tumors. So that's pretty acceptable. Where the big risk is contralateral breast cancer. And that risk could be up to 80% for a BRCA1 carrier. So in your group, Grace, how do you feel about breast conservation in BRCA1 and 2?
It's been a while since I've worked up a breast cancer patient with BRCA1 or BRCA2. But typically, because the risk is so high, like you're mentioning, for cancer in the other breast, you know, bilateral mastectomy is always put on the table as an option. And having patients understand what type of surveillance they're going to have on an annual basis, you know, twice a year, with a lower threshold for biopsies, as long as they have that healthy breast, as long as they understand some of the implications of not doing the bilateral surgery.
Yeah, the surveillance can be a burden sometimes, especially mm-hmm. callbacks every year. Get fed up with that and say, we're done. Let's just finish this.
Well, I think she decided to finish it. And so she did a bilateral mastectomy. And so the question is it safe to do nipple sparing mastectomy?
And I would say absolutely. There's quite a large collection of reports now that encompass thousands of BRCA mutation carriers, and a well-done nipple sparing mastectomy is going to be very effective at reducing breast cancer risk. The literature says it's a lifetime risk of about 7%. Probably, you know, I think it's much, much less in certain hands. I'll just say that. And then is there something, and I don't know if there's a question about, what else would you get, Grace, in terms of other cancers and surveillance and, you know, because we're done with the breasts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so for women, they're high risk for ovarian cancer. The risk can be up, this was BRCA1, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it could be up to a 40% risk with BRCA1. And then we know prostate cancer, you know, men, a lot of times with BRCA mutations, we're thinking so much of the women, but men have an increased risk as well for prostate cancer. There's also possible increased risk for pancreatic cancer. Again, it's higher with BRCA2, so we'd have to look at the family history and see what other cancers are in the family as far as whether to recommend any additional screening. But for women, it's mainly the breast cancer risk, the ovaries, and for men in the family, is the prostate cancer risk. Did I leave anything out?
Dr. Oihus, for patients like this, where they have one of those pathogenic mutations, like in BRCA1, would you recommend removing the ovaries in somebody who's done having children?
Absolutely, yeah. And I'd encourage them to be done if they're, because people are having it so late now, but we kind of like to get the ovaries out by 40. And that has been shown to improve their survival. Doing the contralateral mastectomy has not been shown to improve survival, not in any convincing way, but removing the ovaries is going to impact their survival, and we would be very enthusiastic about it. She's already 48, so she's it would be like, we might even do it as a combined procedure, you know, when we do her breast surgery. Laparoscopic salpingo oophorectomy.
Well, so I think that wraps up our case. And I know we're a little over time, but if anybody here has any burning questions or wants to ask Dr. Oihus or Grace anything about the cases or about what they've presented today, feel free to unmute yourself. We'll give just a couple seconds just in case. And just a reminder that we'll be sending out the list, of the resources that are in these slides will be sent out to you along with the evaluation for this webinar. And I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Mollenkopf to wrap us up and close us out.
All right. Thank you so much. Wow. Really incredible. I have to say, I think this is my favorite webinar that we've hosted in our series so far. So thank you. Thank all of you so much. Again, the Conversations in Genetics series is funded by the Maryland Health Education Commission, and it's part of our overall initiative to increase the knowledge of genetics and genomics of nurses throughout Maryland. We have an active community of practice with nurses from different schools, different settings, other health professionals, and all are welcome to join. The contact info is in the chat box. And as Dr. Wilder said, we will share the resources and actually the community of practice information after the webinar. So thank you all for being here. Thank you to our planning committee. Also thank you to our multimedia staff, Rafe, Florentina, and Matt. And have a good night.